Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. Let's talk a little bit more analytic techniques. Let's go over electrophoresis in this video. So the principle of electrophoresis is that it is a separation of charged compounds in a liquid medium under the influence of an electric field. It is commonly used to separate proteins. The greater the charge used, the faster it moves towards the oppositely charged electrode. So if it's negatively charged, I'll go to the positive electrode. If it's positively charged, I'll go towards the negative electrode. The charge of the molecule will depend on the pH of the solution. The components of the electrophoresis machinery is going to be the driving force of the power that can be applied. The support medium, what the sample is put in, it's usually going to be a form of gel. The buffer, that is the liquid that the sample in the support medium is going to be in, and then a detecting system of some sort to read the bands, stain and read the bands after the electrophoresis. So once the proteins are separated, the support media are stained to visualize the bands, and you can use densiometry, which is going to read the absorbance. Again, it looks for molecularity and thickness of the band. To find the concentration of each fraction. So this is what I mean when I mean band. So it's going to separate proteins. It's usually like a reference one here, usually kind of like a DNA ladder or something like that. And then you would have each sample would be in one of these columns. And then depending on the makeup of the sample, the proteins will separate and stop at different areas and be in different concentration at different areas of the gel, depending on how far they migrate from where they were loaded. So the components of electrophoresis are the support materials. So that can be cellulose, acetate, agarose gel, polyacrylamide gel, or starch gel. And so you make up the support material, and then you're going to take the gel and load it in the chamber. The chamber can be horizontal or vertical. And you're going to add buffer, and the buffer will control pH and ionic strength, which will affect the charge of the protein molecules. The proteins can be, they're amphilites, so they can be positive or negatively charged depending on the pH of the solution they're in. So the ions of the buffer will carry the electric current and allow the buffer to maintain its pH. If the buffer is more acidic than the isoelectric point of the protein, the protein will bind hydrogen ion and will become positively charged, and it will move towards the anode. If the buffer is more basic than the isoelectric point, then it will lose hydrogen ions and become negatively charged and will move towards the cathode. And then when you have loaded the gel and poured the buffer in the chamber, then you load the sample in their little holes, little wells in the gel, load the samples all the way across, and then you will turn on the power supply that will provide a constant current or voltage to the chamber. This is what the chambers look like. So this is a horizontal one. This is a vertical one. You can see clearly in this horizontal one, the negative and or the anode is going to be black. Electrical stuff is always color-coded the same, right? The cathode or positive end is going to be red. You can see this is one big gel here. There's buffer in there, and then you can see where they've loaded samples in these wells across the top of this gel. They're going to apply the power, and then these are going to move through the gel. They'll apply the power for a set number of time, 30 minutes or whatever, and then turn it off, and then see the band patterns in the gel. But again, you visualize it usually by staining it in some way or another. So what are the applications? The analysis of proteins in serum, urine, spinal fluid, and red cells, more specifically hemoglobin. So you can do serum or urine protein electrophoresis. You would get this kind of pattern of density when you read the band. So that means the most dense, or where you would have the most, is going to be albumin, because that's half of the serum proteins. Then the next band to migrate, so this is the first one, the next one's going to be the alpha 1 globulins, then we have the alpha 2 globulins, then the beta 1, then the beta 2, and then the gamma globulins, which are your antibodies. And then we can see if there's abnormal amounts in any of those, and that can help diagnose several different diseases. In spinal fluid, you can also do electrophoresis, and you would be looking mostly for increased IgG in spinal fluid, which is often indicative of multiple sclerosis, but is definitely not the only thing that can cause an increase in IgG in spinal fluid. And then hemoglobin electrophoresis can be used to detect abnormal forms of hemoglobin, such as hemoglobin S and hemoglobin C. So this is another way to portray it. This is where the bands would migrate, so from the wells here, and then will migrate. And so you can see hemoglobin A migrates to this area, hemoglobin F migrates here, and so this is a homozygous beta thalassemia right here. And then the S and the C is sickle cell trait. If they only have hemoglobin S, that would be sickle cell. Anyway, so there's a way to analyze hemoglobin to find the abnormal hemoglobins. There are several types of electrophoresis that can be done. We have zone electrophoresis. It separates by charge and uses agarose gels. Isoelectrophocusing uses polyacrylamide gels with a pH gradient that's set, right? And it's a modified electrophoresis procedure that immobilizes the proteins at the neutral pH. And then in 2D electrophoresis, it uses isoelectrophocusing as the first step, followed by an SES page method. And I can never remember the D in SES is sodium something or another, and then page is polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. And that's that second step then sorts the proteins by size and not charge. And there's also some blotting techniques. So we can separate DNA and DNA fragments by agarose gel electrophoresis, and then that pattern can be blotted on a natural cellulose paper, literally blotted and transferred over, and detected with hybridized nucleic acid probes. You can also do RNA and proteins that way. And then there's capillary electrophoresis. It uses a narrow bore fused silica capillary to separate large and small molecules. It uses high electric field strengths. It separates on charge, size, and hydrophobicity. It has a wider range of applications. It is part of automation now. So this is one of the parts of electrophoresis that has been able to be automated, because otherwise electrophoresis is a very manual method. It has the highest resolution, and it is more consistent and standardized. So, all right, that wraps up electrophoresis. I will see you in the next video.